Hello and welcome. My name is Jim Logan. I'm the clarinet professor at the University of Texas, El Paso, and I'm here today to discuss the opening of the second 2024 TMEA All-Region All-State Etude, the Andante Cantabile, found on page 66, and it's number 21 in our wonderful collection of rows, 32 Etudes. So the tempo marking that is here, first of all, if you haven't gone and listened to my recording that was put out there by our good friends with the TMEA folks, please go online and do that. If you're having trouble locating or whatever, just let me know by email at the end of this video. You can see that. I'll tell you where it is. But you should go online, look at that video, listen to what I have to say, listen to me playing it. This video, purpose of this video is not for you to hear me play it again, because you've already done that if you've done your homework at this point and listened to Etude. So what we're going to discuss here is in greater detail how to tackle this and decipher all of this. And the first thing I want to talk about is tempo here. It's an Andante Cantabile. In the book, it says it's quarter note equals 76, but if you've looked at my errata, my suggestions, the tempos should be from 64 to 74. I would err on the slower etudes always at being a little on the slower side. I'm saying this as I bring up a metronome. The reason for you want to start on this on the slower side is some of this played up to tempo is going to sound like clown music. I mean, it's just going to be ridiculous. So err on the side of being on the slower side. So I would say closer to 64 than 74. This you have to be careful in starting this etude. Any slow work that starts off with a pretty simple melody or rhythm, it's very easy to start it too fast, right? And that's all well and fine if you start, okay, that's all fine, but then you get down to the 16th notes, you know, that's too fast to be an andante, and it's much more difficult from a technical standpoint. So anytime you're starting a slow work, look at a more technical portion of that work, in this case, the 16ths that I said, and count yourself listening in your head to those 16th notes. Ba da da ti, 3 ti teta, 4 ti teta, 1. Here's 64. 3 ti teta. Well, look at that. I was right on at the 64. Okay. So, again, the word of caution, err on the side of a little on the slower side. The danger, though, is now your phrases are much longer, and if you have some breathing issues or inability to sustain long phrases, those are going to be much more apparent to the judges. So you got to pick your poison there and find where that line works for you. Okay, and then another question I've gotten about this is, do I think of this as being in 4, or do I think of it as being in 8? And that's a question I get all the time. And you know, if you've looked at any of my videos, you know that there are some things that I have very strong opinions about in terms of fingerings and in different things. And then there are a number of things where I really don't know that there's a wrong answer. It's a preference. And whether you're counting this in 4 or counting it in 8, is up to you. There's no wrong answer, right? As long as whether you're counting in 4 and playing, thinking 1, te, 3, te, 4, te, 1, or if you're thinking of it in 8, thinking 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, the melody is all the same. Nobody's going to be able to tell whether you're thinking in 4 or 8. So the last thing I'm going to say about this counting it in 4, counting it 8 in business is this. For those that know me, I say it all the time, I'm all about why. So why 4 versus 8? to add to what I've already stated, and again, just my opinion, but in my opinion, what I'll have happen, and I've done it myself, is that I'll be thinking of something in subdivision, like in eight, and then suddenly I'll slip back into four. So again, here's your opening melody, and if I'm thinking of it at eight, I'm thinking one, four, or yeah, one, four, five, six, seven, eight, one, tay, three, right? But that may not be the rhythm that ends up coming out. It would be this. You flip back and forth. So another one of my watchwords or key phrases or whatever that I use is consistency. And I found that, again, just my opinion, that sets up the student consistency with where the downbeats are. And in this, if it was really, really slow, I might defer to counting an eight, but this is not really that slow. And there aren't a lot of 30-second notes to worry about here as well. You know, one tati tati is manageable. Okay, so enough on that, we'll move on. Dynamics. Okay, so musicality, I want musicality and technical etude, certainly in a beautiful lyric like this. The dynamics are absolutely very important, okay? And look up all of these words that are written here, okay? I don't know that I'm gonna be saying this with the correct pronunciation, but dolce e placido, which is sweet and peacefully, okay? If you have the book, you look in the back of your book and all of those words are written in the back of the book, okay? And I would say probably 75% of the words in the back of that book, you'll never see them anywhere else. But the fact is, they're on the page. You have to figure it out and you adhere to those words of guidance. Sometimes they're not crucial to be followed, but in a lot of cases, they are crucial to be followed. So look them all up. So right out of the gate again, make sure you're giving a very solid, soft to forte dynamic, and then watch out that last note in the second measure is accented for some reason. It should be soft, so you can maybe accent a little bit. I think the accent is going to happen naturally because we're up a fourth here, so maybe don't push that, but the tendency is going to be for that to be hammered out. Here's the second measure. You know, it doesn't need to be that. In fact, I would venture that if I were playing it, I would think of trying to match the A the same dynamic as I played the E. And there's another tricky spot with a right-left combination. If you've listened to other videos in which I talk about fingering choices, some of are up to the individual. Some, I think, are very important that they be followed, as I'm going to direct in this case, that C sharp on the downbeat of the third measure be on the right side, followed by D, followed by C sharp on the right side, B sharp, same as C, to C sharp on the right and F sharp, okay? Yes, you could play the C sharp on the left and D and C sharp on the left and B sharp and C sharp. You could do that, okay? But it's time to learn some of these fingerings in the right hand. And the fact is that my mantra is, again, all of my whys, there's a reason for them. We want to include as many notes in the same hand as possible. So once we get from that A, we have C sharp on the right, D on the right, C sharp on the right. We have one note over there that we have to change hands on, followed by C sharp on the right, F sharp on the right. So all of that, most of that motion is in the right hand. That's the reason why. And yeah, you could get away with using the first F C sharp you ever learn as a fifth or sixth grader. You could do that, but it's going to come back to bite you later. Trust me, if you don't learn that combination of notes now, okay? And the last thing I will say on that is that C sharp on the right is the closest to your right hand. C sharp on the left is the furthest key from your left hand. So why would you choose something that's going to be the furthest away when you've got the when you've got a closer combination, which once you get past the beginner portion of that fingering, learning that fingering, then it is going to be smoother ultimately. Not initially, because it's new, but that B on the upbeat of beat three should be on the left side, B, C sharp, okay? Again, B on the right side is the furthest from the right hand, C sharp on the left side is the furthest from the left hand. So why would you do that when you got the closest and the closest, okay? B on the left, C sharp on the right. Just like we would do B on the left and C natural to the right, if it was C natural, right? Let's see, what else? Measure four, C sharp on the right side, B on the left, C sharp on the right, D, and then D sharp, same as E flat, up to the E. Fork fingering, the last note in measure five, followed by E sharp, same as E natural, or F natural, sorry, E sharp, same as F natural, followed by fork fingering, F sharp. Make sure that accidental E sharp carries through, D sharp, E sharp again, and then fork. So you have three fork fingerings there. Here's number measure five and six. Okay. And please note in measure five, the crescendo is not to the C sharp. The crescendo is to the B, to beat three, okay? Okay, the judges are going to hear plenty of. That's just not correct. Okay, it's follow the ink there. Let's see. I think more of the same here. There is a subito or suddenly change in dynamic there in measure nine. So the last note of measure eight is piano. The downbeat of measure nine is mezzo forte. Make that happen. So here's measure eight and nine. Okay. Let's see, A sharp, same as B flat in measure nine. And that C sharp of a second to the last note in measure 11 should be C sharp on the right hand. E, D, C sharp, D, C sharp on the right, downbeat of measure 12. Try and keep all of the finger motion in the same hand, okay? And the last thing I'm gonna say about this before signing off on this part of the etude is the importance of fingers being curved and close to the keys, okay? So this is generally something that comes up in technical etudes, but I'm gonna mention it here because we've got with this cadenza portion in measure 15 coming up, there's a lot of kind of a technical flourishes going on here. And if you're not in that curved C position, you're gonna have a problem. So we're looking for curve, not pencil fingers, not the death grip, okay? That's too tense. So the fingers move at their best with fluidity when the fingers are curved. So you should be practicing that, especially with the little fingers seem to be sticking point with many, including myself. And so be judicious and be watching out for the tendency to want to curve or keep the fingers straight and what have you, okay? So I think I'll just play this a portion up to the downbeat of 15 and then we'll sign off for today. So here's the beginning. I better get my metronome. Let's make sure we're legit here. Add 64 is what we're looking for, okay? All right. That's plenty fast. I wouldn't want to go any faster than that. One, and you're counting yourself off before you start, always. Not just on game day, not just at auditions, every time you start the practices. One, two, ready. So a couple of thoughts there. Good idea to add some musicality there, maybe a little bit of a ritardando into measure 15, stretch the high D at the top. I think adding breaths in generally in these slow etudes is not something that we're looking for, but there are some exceptions to that rule, and in measure 13 and 14 is an exception. We have a breath after the downbeat of measure 13. You can add a breath on those staccato eighth notes. Staccato means separated. So during that separation, as long as you don't lose the time and as long as you don't accent the note after the breath, you should be fine. Pickups into 13 like this. And there's a crescendo through there, so make it careful about the accenting on the A's. Be pretty subtle with that. And so stay tuned for the second half of this etude. I have more words starting in measure 15 with the cadenza. So keep practicing. Hang in there.